This world is a place of almost indescribable beauty. But it is also a place of almost indescribable evil and pain. And yet again, there are those who risk their lives to save others and bring healing where there is pain.
As we begin our exploration of biblical principles that will help us to understand today's public policies in a biblical Christian manner, we begin with God's good and perfect creation and how it was spoiled.
You know, a lot of the pictures in the Christian art that we get of the garden sort of show Adam and Eve sort of lounging around in the garden, but we get a very different feel for what God had in mind in creating them and placing them in a garden from the Genesis account. God placed human beings in a kind of raw garden, but they have begun to fill that garden with the works of human hands, technology and schedules and labeling systems and all that kind of thing. And in all of that, they are to glorify God. They're to do all these things to the glory of God. And so we get a kind of work in the garden that God places them. And this is the filling of the garden with the products of human labor.
But something went tragically wrong in God's perfect garden. Adam and Eve rebelled against their maker when they ate of the one tree they had been told not to eat. The world is no longer as it is supposed to be. It is broken. The hearts and wills of human beings, including our own hearts and wills, are not as they are supposed to be.
Then, not long after the fall, they try to build a tower that reaches to the heavens. That is, their technological activity becomes an act of disobedience to God, a serving of their own sinful impulses. Cain and Abel is another good example of the ways in which the fall of our first parents spread into murder.
The great Russian Christian writer Alexander Solzhenitsyn expressed the tragic truth accurately. If only there were evil people somewhere insidiously committing evil deeds, and it were necessary only to separate them from the rest of us and destroy them. But the line dividing good and evil cuts through the heart of every human being.
Alexander Solzhenitsyn is right when he says the line between good and evil runs through all human beings' hearts. This means evil lies in the hearts not only of the Osama bin Ladens of the world, but also in our nation's leaders and politicians and in the hearts of us as citizens and voters. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The political world as we see it today is not as it is supposed to be. But, and this is crucial, sin and the resulting evil is not the end of the Christian story. It is only the beginning.
Christians who are sensitive to the defection, rebellion, folly in the world are sometimes in danger of presenting a message that sounds like this. It sounds like, I've got some bad news for you, and I've got some bad news for you. But that's to forget that the center of the Christian world is not our sin, but our Savior. That's the center of the gospel message.
Yeah, there's an old theological slogan that I love. It says, redemption restores creation. And if we're created to glorify God in all that we do, in our personal relationships, in the way we treat the non-human creation, the way we raise animals and raise crops, we have to take seriously what the apostle says, that whatsoever you do in word and deed, do all to the honor and glory of God. That when we're redeemed by Jesus Christ, he wants to redeem all of life, all of that which was broken and wounded by sin.
The biblical message is that the whole world belongs to God. The whole world has fallen, and so the whole world has to be redeemed. Every person, place, people group, organization, program, system. That's a very big worldview and a very big view of who Jesus Christ is.
This very big view of Jesus Christ and what he came to do includes the political world. The political world belongs to God, The political world has fallen, and so the political world needs to be redeemed.
Salvation from sin is certainly helpful once we die. However, it's also very helpful while we're alive, too. I mean, to be saved from sin and to continue to live in sin is a contradictory. So obviously, it has to mean something now.
Yeah, I mean, if we really take seriously this idea that we're born again, that we're made new people in Christ, mm-hmm. then that ought to, you know, be in evidence in our relationships with other people and how we conduct our daily lives and, you know, how we go out into the world and interact with it.
Well, I think that Christ has called us to action. And so there's a direct correlation to public policy in that the actions that we take as members of a society, we are calling on our government to feed the hungry and to house the homeless and to clothe the naked and to visit those in prison. So I think as Christians, we do have an obligation to take action as Christ called us to take action. And if you think about Christ were to return today, you know, where would he go and what would he do? He probably wouldn't come to visit my church or your church. He would probably go down to some red light district or find a skid row where he could reach out to those people that he came to save.
Yeah, I agree. I think that we're called to redeem the parts of the world that we can. One of the liberating messages of the resurrection is that the world doesn't have to stay the way that it is. And, you know, we as the church are called to be or embody Christ in this world until he comes again. At the same time, while he's already come and the victory's already won, it's not yet and won't be fully realized until he comes again. We still live in a fallen world that's imperfect, where, you know, evil reigns and violence is rampant. And I think we need to take that into consideration when we start thinking about public policy.
I came across this quote by Martin Luther King Jr., and he said, "How can you say that you're passionate about souls when you're indifferent toward the slums in which those souls reside?"